are faithful to the end. From before time, through time, beyond time, forever, God, you are faithful.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail me yet. You're still enough. You keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Yeah.
And to all, glad that all of you are here. It's our time to go and worship our God. You know, I know that we come here each Sunday and we know why we are here, but just a reminder, and the fact that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. And we take this time to go and worship our God. So here in the sanctuary, those of you who are in our patio, those of you who are online, just want to welcome you. But let's go and take this time to go and worship our God together. So why don't you go and stand with me if you can, and let me pray, and let us go and worship him. So Lord, I just come before you. We thank you for this time. We thank you that we can come each Sunday and be reminded over and over again of why we are here. In the fact that, you know what, you came from heaven to earth so that way we can go and experience what true life is like. So here in this church, Lord God, you know, we call it a church to call home. We pray, Lord God, that you would make it a home for many, many people. And, you know, not just to go and have fellowship with others, but really to have fellowship with you. So we take this time to worship, Lord God, you. We welcome you into this place. We glorify you because you deserve all glory. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Living Hope. We're glad you're here. Let's all praise our God together this morning. gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hope, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hope, my shepherd
before you guys sit down, why don't you take this time to go and welcome one another. Welcome at least two or three other people. Those of you in the patio, please do the same. I know it's much more colder, so warm up your hands before you go and give each other a handshake. And we want to welcome those of you online as well. So I want to welcome all of you. Thank you guys for just joining us on this Sunday. Great. Beautiful people. I love worshiping with all of you. It's just fun. You know, I just want to welcome those of you, maybe you're here for the first time, or maybe you've been visiting for a while, and you have not visited our welcoming booth yet. So right outside these doors in the lobby, please go and sign, fill out one of our communication cards. We'd love to get to know you guys. We would be sending out just more information on what's happening here at Living Hope. So please do that. They even have a free gift for you, okay? Another thing for those of you who are members of our church, just a reminder, you know, we thank you for all the things that you're doing to continually help us to do ministry here from Living Hope. You know, we just had our food pantry, great success every single time we do it. But just a reminder, you can give online, you can give out in the patio, there is a small little box that you can drop off your offering, or you can do it through our app, okay? I have three other announcements for you. One is we do have membership coming up. And, you know, as a church, we continually want to build this church. We want to build it with people just like yourselves. And so if you would like to go and be a part of being a part of a member of our church, the next class will be starting on February 4th. You have to sign up online. There's four classes that you need to go to. It's painless, but at the same time, it's well worth it to learn more about the church. You know, what is it that we do, the mission, the values, and everything that we have as a church. And so please sign up and be a member, okay? Another thing that is coming up is we know that we're going through our pastoral succession, and we're thankful for Pastor Steve for serving, Pastor Steve and also Hannah for serving for the last 30 years. But we are in the process of really kind of praying through, you know, who the next pastoral leader will be, head pastor for our church. And so we invite you, if you look, there's going to be a QR code on your screen. You can sign up for our prayer times for our pastoral succession. And there's going to be time from early evening all the way into early morning praying for our next pastor. Please sign up. You can sign up as an individual. You can sign up with your cell groups, sign up with your friends, and take those 20-minute slots. And it's very important as we get into this whole season, okay? And the last one is this, and you'll see this screen that's coming up. It's kind of like a bittersweet, you know, happy, sad type of announcement. We do have our Ben Clement, who's been our worship leader, our assistant worship director here for many, many years. He has blessed us so much, but his work is taking him out of state. And so his last days will be on January 28th. He is not here today. So when he does come back next week, make sure you guys kind of welcome him and, you know, talk to Margie. Just kind of remind them of all the years and thanking them for the years of service that they've had with us. Okay. And the other one of good news is that Noah, is he here? Noah Dennis? I know he's hiding. No, he's actually in the youth service that's happening over there. We are actually going to, he's been here, brought him in last year as halftime or quarter time, or not yet, three quarter time. We're going to bring him on full time. And so he's going to be our full time missions and also youth director. And so if you see him, just congratulate him. Let him know. Since he's full time, you can tell him what to do. As pastors, we are here to serve you. So tell him what to do. I think he'll love that. Okay. And right now we have our elders' prayer. So I have Peter Park coming up right now.
Good morning, church. Please bow your heads as we pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this Sunday and for the opportunity to worship corporately as a church body. Thank you for today's service, for the staff and volunteers as they give their time in their various ministries to serve you. Please bless them in their service to others. I pray for our speaker this morning, Pastor James, as we start our sermon series, Why Church Matters. We've heard from prior messages about the concerning trend on the decreasing attendance and church involvement. Lord, we know you are in control, and I pray that you use Living Hope to further your kingdom, to lead a revival and renewal. We place our trust in you and humbly submit to you. In this new year, there's so much to be thankful for. I thank you for the addition of the two new services starting today, the 8 a.m. service and the 11:30 youth service. It's been almost 4 years since we had to change due to the pandemic, and I am so excited about what this means for the church. Please bless the staff and volunteers who selflessly give their time and effort in their work to make this happen. I know that these additions are such a blessing for many people here today. I also pray for our current senior pastor search. A lot of people have been praying and have raised their hands to be a part of this important event for the future of Living Hope. We trust you and thank you for your blessings during this search. Also lift up Pastor Steve and Hannah during this year as this process unfolds and you work in them for the next stage of their lives. Lastly, I want to thank you for today, a great day where we install new elders and deacons. Thank you for these servant leaders, men and women who humbly serve you. Please bless them in all they do in their ministries. Again, thank you, Lord, for loving us and our church. Amen.
Well, hello there, everybody. It's so good to be here with you all today, in particular, worshiping our God. My name is James. I'm one of the pastors here at Living Hope, and I've been a pastor about 13 years or so, but I wasn't always a believer. In fact, it was back in 2009 when I was saved by God, and about a year before that, in 2008, was when I returned to the local church, and I didn't return to this one, all right, not Living Hope. I grew up in some other church, a smaller congregation nearby, and that was the only church that I knew, so I naturally returned there. And some of you guys might know this, but my story is that I struggled with about 10 years of drug addiction and different related issues that God had really rescued me from. And so back in 2008, everything was just really fresh and broken up. I'd come back to my local church, and it's a small church. I grew up in it. I knew everybody. Everybody knows me, that kind of setting. And I recognized these two guys. They were not from there. Turns out the night before, they were out drinking in K-Town by one of my childhood friends, and she dragged them out to church that morning. Sound familiar? Hopefully not too familiar, huh? Anyway, one of the guys is during sermon, and we're in a space that's, you know, as big as about Chapel One or so, and the walls are very thin, and the restrooms are attached next to the hallway. One of the guys gets up, and I'm thinking, okay, he's probably gonna use the restroom, right? And sure enough, he goes, and I'm hearing, like, the door creaking open or whatever, and then the pastor's going, and all of a sudden, we start hearing him throwing up. Pastor's like, and God said, sorry, God, I don't know if that was offensive to you or not, I'm not sure. That guy became the youth pastor of the church later. Crazy, crazy. Grace is crazy. And I remember sitting there, as soon as I heard, and I was like, dude, that guy's going to hell. And you know, let me remind you, I wasn't even a believer. I had just returned to church after 10 years of personal wrestling and struggling, and I didn't subscribe into even the dichotomy of heaven and hell, and yet here I was instantly, oh, throwing up during sermon, hell. Probably true, right? Like, I don't know, you know? But I remember that day so vividly because how quick I was to judge this person. And if you are like me, judging is ingrained in us. We're really good at it. And for some of us, to be really clear, I think our issues, maybe primary issues for some of us, is self-embatterment. Like, we put down ourselves a little bit too much. And I recognize that others wrestle with mental illnesses, different conditions that makes it really complicated and difficult. But for most of us, we are so quick to make assumptions and make conclusions that are rather negative and judgy about others. Is that right? And this judgment tendency, this judgmental mindset is not really a modern human trend, but rather it seems to be like a historical human thing, because Jesus in Matthew chapter 7 says, "Judge not, ye be judged." And then he goes on to explain that we humans can get caught up thinking about the speck in our brother or our sister's eye rather than paying attention and realizing that there's a log in our own eye. We are really good at judging other people. And you would agree, I think, that as we judge, divisions happen. the church, unfortunately, has been also really good at this pattern of judgment and division. We are really good at making a big deal out of secondary differences. What do I really mean by that? Well, I'm talking about doctrines, right? There's primary doctrine. So for example, the resurrection of Christ, that Christ Jesus actually existed in a real person and that he actually really died and that he physically rose again. That's, in a nutshell, doctrine of resurrection. That's a primary doctrine, right? If you ever go to a church and that church doesn't believe in that, then that's not a Christian church. I generally take whatever is written in the Apostles' Creed as the primary doctrine. But there are also secondary differences, secondary doctrines such as baptism. Like, do we baptize babies or do we not? And why not, right? And when we do baptize, do we do one of these, like, you know, WWE, like, let me baptize you, you know? Well, we don't actually do that, by the way. Like, you know what I'm saying, right? Like, or do we, like, gently sprinkle, like, oh, let me baptize you. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's secondary difference. But the church really being good at our talent of judging each other and dividing things up, we have now become 45,000 denominations all over the world. Did you know that there's 45,000 Christian denominations in the globe? I don't even know what they're, I just know Presbyterian and Baptist. Like, what's 45,000? Like, what are they called? I don't know. Like, Presbyterian, Optimus Prime, Omega 3000. Like, I don't know, right? Like, I don't know, you know? And most of these Christian denominations actually came after the Reformation, which was year 1517. Before which, there were really two denominations, maybe three, right? There was the Eastern Orthodox Church, and then there was the Catholic Church. And sure, you can count like the Egyptian Coptics and whatnot. But now there are 45,000, just 2,000 to 3,000 to 45,000. And yes, you know, I do find beauty in diversity, right? Diversity of expressions and unity in diversity, as is sometimes referred. And I do certainly respect theological differences. I get that. But 45,000 seems a little too much to me. In fact, when we examine church history, we will easily see that it's full of infighting, schism, and division that have hurt people and that have driven people away from Christ. And if the church is so imperfect, intolerant of those who are different, then why should we care? Why does it matter? And indeed, we are on the mini-series, Why Church Matters. It's just a 3-week part. This is message number 2. And today, what I hope to do with you is to really wrestle with this question of why does a church matter, even though it's so imperfect, out of the book of Acts, chapter 11, verses 1 through 18. So I want to give you a little time to turn there, Acts chapter 11, verses 1 through 18. That's the text that we want to examine today. The book of Acts, chapter 11, verses 1 through 18. Before I start reading, and I want to read in chunks, right? I want to divide it up into two segments. Let me give you a little bit of context of Acts chapter 11 while you are finding the text. Acts 11 and Acts 10 are actually the same stories. It's a repeated story. What happens is Peter, the first disciple, goes to Cornelius, a Roman commander, preaches the gospel to Cornelius. He comes to accept the gospel. And then not only Cornelius, but all of his followers, like his household and his soldiers under him, become believers as well. And then in chapter 11 is a story of Peter going back to Jerusalem and reporting it to the church. And he's going to essentially say the same things that we are told in chapter 10. So it's a little bit of a repeat there. That's the context that we're on today. So this is how the story goes. Let me read for you the word of God. Out of Acts chapter 11, verses 1 through 18, I'm going to read up to verse 12. Now the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party criticized him, saying, "You went to uncircumcised men and ate with them." But Peter began and explained it to them in order. I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending, being let down from heaven by its four corners. And it came down to me. Looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air. And I heard a voice saying to me, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But I said, "By no means, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth." But the voice answered a second time from heaven, "What God has made clean, do not call common." This happened three times. And all was drawn up again into heaven. And behold, at that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were, sent to me from Caesarea. And the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. What's going on here? So Peter goes to Cornelius, a Roman soldier, a commander, a centurion, and he is mobilized by God through visions and confirmations and leading of the Spirit. And then he preaches the gospel to Cornelius, and he comes to accept the gospel, him and his household, him and his soldiers. And then when he comes back to Jerusalem church to report it, the church says, "You ate with the wrong people. You hung out with the wrong crowd." And then Peter defends himself, right? These Jewish people, or these circumcision people, were those who thought that believing in Jesus required still following certain ritualistic laws. There are hundreds of ritualistic laws in the Old Testament, but Christ came and he fulfilled the law, as we call it, meaning he made all of those laws obsolete. They are no longer need to be kept by the church, except two commands that Jesus gave us, which is love the Lord your God and love your neighbors as you love yourself. But here were some of the earliest Christians, the circumcision people, who still held on to their tradition, who thought, no, it's not just Christ, but it's Christ plus certain rules. And Peter is criticized by them for hanging out with these Romans. And then he defends himself by telling them, "Oh, but I had a vision, and these people came at this time, and the vision repeated, and, you know, blah, blah, blah." What does this story have to do with why the church matters, even through its imperfections? Well, as I mentioned, back in 2008, I returned to the local church, and in 2009, I was saved by God. In 2010, I entered seminary, and in 2011, I was married. And then in 2012, I became rich. People laughed at last service, too. I remember looking back at those years. I mean, things were rapidly changing, right? Things were developing for the better, and man, it was crazy times. And my attitude, I would say in those years is, I was on a quest to be holy. Like I was on a quest to be holier than thou. Does that make sense? One time my wife and I were talking, and she was like saying something, "Oh, you know, like blah, 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 said blah, blah, blah." And then she, da, 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 da. "Oh, and that was so awesome." I looked at her straight in the face. I said, "You can't say that's awesome. Only God is awesome. I'm watching you." I painfully recognize how short of grace and maturity I was. And I was a pastor at that time. I was leading a ministry. I was supposed to be an example of godliness. You know why the church is so messed up? It's because people are messed up. And the church is made of people. We all know this, right? Church is not a building. It's a community of people. It's a gathering. The church, it's not imperfect because it's a church problem. It's imperfect because it's a human problem. Notice how in verse 3, the circumcision party criticizes Peter for hanging out with the wrong people. "You went to uncircumcised men and ate with them." Yet God's vision to Peter repeated three times that ensues, right? Verses 4 through beyond 9 or so, is about wrong food. In fact, there not being any wrong food. Did you catch that? On the one hand, circumcision party is judging Peter because they had already judged the Romans. They're the wrong people. Peter was hanging out with the wrong people. That was their issue. And yet the issue that God was trying to address was there is no such thing as wrong food. Notice the quick tendency to judge others in the circumcision party. Yes, it's true. If you examine the Old Testament, many, many laws about what is unclean, things, food, customs, people, including Jewish people, they can also be labeled unclean at times due to certain activities or lack of certain things. But again, as Christ has made all of those things obsolete, the issue was no longer what was unclean. But yet here they are. Instead of saying, wow, you evangelized to the Romans and they come to accept the gospel, they said, you hung out with the wrong people. How about us? Are we better than this? Or are we similar to them? Isn't it true that in our cell groups or in our ministries, if you're serving, or even in this very worship service, if there is someone that you don't like, you've written him off or her off because she annoyed you or he frustrated you or somehow, you know, you don't like how he looks or what she wears or what he said or she did makes you feel insecure or anxious, isn't it true that if there is someone that you don't like, that person cannot do anything right? And vice versa, if there is someone that you like, or if there's an affinity towards that person, you think well of them for whatever reason, you guys connect, oh, she laughs at your jokes, or whatever it is, isn't it also true that that person actually could do no wrong? In fact, they could be doing the same things, and you simply can overlook it. Church is certainly imperfect. It is messed up. It's done many wrong things. But actually, that's because you and I are imperfect. And our attitude ought to be more humble and open rather than judgy and divisive. You know, Pastor Albert, one of our pastors, him and I were talking this week, and he told me something really enlightening that he had heard from a philosophy podcast. And this podcast said, you know, when you are in traffic, you are not in traffic. You are traffic. Lord? Wow. I'll never look at traffic the same way ever again. In a similar sense, you and I certainly have received some wrongdoings at church, out of ignorance, out of misfortune, out of intentionality even. But it is also true that we have contributed to the wrongs and the problems and the messiness of what we call the local church. We need humility and openness like Christ has. Let's continue on as our need for humility and openness isn't really the full answer to why the church matters. Starting with verse 13. And he told us how he had seen the angel stand. This is Cornelius, right? Cornelius told Peter and his people how Cornelius had seen the angel stand in his house and say, send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. Peter will declare to you a message by which you will be saved, you and all your household. As Peter began to speak, that means, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us in the beginning. And I remember the word of the Lord, how he said, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? When they heard these things and they fell silent, they meaning the circumcision party, and they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to eternal life. So then what's happening once again is Peter and Cornelius are arranged by God through prayer and visions and timely meetings that they are led and they connect with each other, they meet. And then Peter proclaims the gospel to Cornelius. Cornelius comes to accept not just him and his household, him and the soldiers. Peter goes back to the Jerusalem church. He reports that the church, the circumcisers, they criticize Peter. And then Peter defends himself by explaining what had happened. And then, to my surprise at least, the circumcision party is convinced. This is surprising to me because in the Gospels, the Pharisees are never convinced. In fact, they are continuously hardened as Jesus continues his ministry. Excuse me. The circumcision party is convinced that the Romans belong to the church. Once again, back in 2008 and 2009 or so, I had returned to the church and I was in a not good state. I was unstable. I needed something, right? I needed a job, really. Like, I needed to make some money. I needed to be productive, but not a full-time one because I just was too fragile and I couldn't handle it. I needed something part-time. So there's something that I can use to get back up on my feet, be disciplined, be productive, and start living some kind of normal life, if I can say it that way. And my youth pastor, I was in my late 20s, my youth pastor was still working at that church. And he was bivocational. He ran a tutoring business for a living. And he connected me to his friend who was also running a tutoring business. And I was able to get a job with her, worked under her for a few years, was able to recover. I was very thankful for that. But several years into working at this place, it occurred to me that my pastor could have hired me himself. And I asked him why, and he said, well, you know, you're such a mess, I didn't trust you. He didn't really want to say that initially. You know, I kind of pulled it out of him. And that's fair, because I really was. In fact, I returned to the church because no one was willing to give me a chance. No one. My friends were gone. I was a difficult person to have in our lives, in their lives. It was costing them mental energy, money, heartache, headache. It wasn't fun to be around me at that time. I was destructive to myself and to others. So they left. My family, my parents are immigrants and they still loved on me. At least my parents did. But they didn't know what to do with me. They were lost, confused, and maybe a little ashamed that their only son amounted to nothing but just a heap of trouble. But the people of the church gave me a chance. They took me in. They cared for me. They spent time with me. They got to know me. Not everyone. I just want to be really clear about that. Not everybody tried, all right? But a few did. And thanks to their care, God gave me faith, community, and belonging. Perhaps you've been feeling out of place here at Living Hope. Maybe it's that you are starting to notice how different you are from everyone else. whatever those differences may be. Or maybe it's that you experience some real frustration and annoyance and even pain. You are mistreated and ignored and you don't feel like people like you. Or maybe it's that you feel invisible, where you've been here for a while, but then you don't really know if this is your community and you don't even know if people know or care, and people seem to be so happy and everybody has their own little group, but then I don't, or I kind of do, but then I'm not sure. If any of that is any relatable to you, then I first want to say that I'm so sorry. That's difficult. But I also want to encourage and remind you today that the church is actually the only place, the only community where the agenda is belonging of all people, because we are gathered simply for God who loves all people. If you work, which I'm sure most of you do, yes, you can have your work friends. Great. But your work is gathered for ultimately one reason, profit. Even if you work at a nonprofit, you need profit. You are being productive for the profit of the company. If you have an interest, maybe you're a cyclist or a weightlifter or a YouTuber or whatever it is that you are into, you can have great connections over those activities too, but those are interest groups. They're gathered for a specific activity. Only the church is the community where the agenda is that simply God loves all. And therefore, all people can belong. Yes, reality is that we get mistreated, sometimes ignored, and even disliked. But the church is made of imperfect people like you and me. Notice how, once again, the circumcision party in verse 18, they accept the Romans as being part of their church. This is rather crazy thing, because this is telling us that Peter, the apostle, right, who think only Christ and Spirit is enough, to circumcision party, who think, no, it needs to be Jesus and the rules, and then to the Romans, who are culturally different, in fact, who are oppressing these two groups. They literally made their life difficult. These people are saying, oh, these guys, yeah, they're part of us. They should definitely be a different denomination. And that gives me hope to see the circumcision party come to accept the Romans, because it tells me that God is working. And not only that, it tells me that God is working in imperfect, broken, messed up people. God is working in traffic too, after all. It's that imperfect people make the church so that imperfect people belong at church. Do you see the dialectical reasoning here? Church matters because it's actually for imperfect people. People like you, people like me, and may I dare say, people who have ignored you, people who have mistreated you, people who have hurt you and annoyed you and frustrated you, all of us. I want to end our time together by noting the how. Like, if why church matters is that it's actually for imperfection, how do we do that? How do we belong well here? Because to be honest, annoying people are still annoying. Amen? You don't have to say amen to that, all right? And my pains still hurt. How do we belong well? I think the clue is in verse 17, which says, if then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? This is Peter's climax of argument, to which the circumcision party is convinced. What gift is Peter referring to here? There are two things that we can find in the text. First of all, the gospel. Verses 13 and 14. He will give you a message by which you and your household will be saved. The gospel. It's that God loves people like you and me, that he gave his one and only son, Christ Jesus, who lived and died a real life and death. Fully man and fully God, as we call it. And then he rose again, literal physical resurrection from the dead by the power of God's Spirit. And that he ascended to heaven, sending us his Spirit. And that one day he will return to make all things right, to renew all things. The gospel, the reality in which that Christian faith is based on, that we subscribe to, that we long for. It's that the gospel has saved you, but it has also saved that annoying person, that weirdo. Oh, that guy that I don't like. Or that girl that bothers me. Secondly, the Holy Spirit. Notice how in the gospel, we are told that Christ ascended to heaven, but when he ascended, he said, I will send you the paraclete, a helper, a counselor. And the Holy Spirit came in Acts chapter 2. Empower the church for a radical life for Christ. They started speaking tongues, doing miracles, kicking out demons. And not just that, but they started to be bold, proclaiming the gospel to the oppressors, living radically by giving away their possessions, loving on the poor and loving each other. And that's how the church began. It's that presence of God that allows us to do things that are more than our capabilities is the same Spirit that is still in you today. And I see so many Christians still living, though, as if this Christian thing is like a checklist to do. I come to church on Sundays. I do my Bible. Those are all great things. But recognize, church, that you are called for more than that. You are called for a life filled with the Holy Spirit, where God's things happen in you and through you, but not just you. In the person that you don't get along with, that person too. For the same gift of God has been given to all of us. I want to plead with you to train our judgmental minds to focus on the commonalities, not our interests, our preferences, and life stages and locations. Yeah, those are all fine too. But really, the gospel of Jesus, that we are all saved by the same story and the power of God in the presence of the Holy Spirit that really allows us to know God and to live this life for Christ. If then God gave us the same gift to you, to me, to the annoying person, to the frustrating person, what can we say? Would you pray with me now? I want to ask you for a minute to think about that one person. That one person. And maybe it's nothing more than, you know, I feel ignored by her, or I don't feel like I fit in with them. Or maybe it's something more serious, like what was actually said and done that was hurtful to you. I'm not asking you to just sweep it under the rug. That's not what I'm saying. And maybe God is calling you at this time to approach that person respectfully and gently and reconcile. But I am asking you for this moment to really remember in prayer that the gospel has been given to them as well as to you. That the Holy Spirit is given to them as well as to you. And in that sense of humility and openness, can we belong to the body of Christ together here at Living Hope? So let's spend a moment in prayer together, church.
Church, if you're ready, then would you rise with us as we respond in the song?
Have a seat. I'm if you saw me walking in a little bit late, because it's because I was speaking at another church, our sister church, Good Stewards Church's English ministry, had their 9th anniversary service. I spoke over there, but I really wanted to be here at this time as we do two really important things. We're going to install our deacons and elders, and we're also going to have a budget report. We're going to hear the report of how we did in 2023 and
and give you an idea of what we believe God wants us to do in 2024. And so for those of you who are home, we're going to cut off the streams, but I believe we're still going to stream to the patio, correct? I'm going to say yes, right? Okay.